Saturday night I was downtown, working for the FBI, sitting in a nest of bad men, whiskey bottles piling high. Bootlegging boozer on the west side, full of people who are doing wrong. Just about to call up the DA man when I heard the woman singing a song. A pair of 45s made me open my eyes. My temperature started to rise. She was a long, cool woman in a black dress, 5'9", beautiful, tall. Just one look, I was a bad mess, 'cause that long, cool woman had it all. I saw her heading to the table with a tall, walking, big black cat. Charlie said, I hope that you're able, boy, 'cause I'm telling you she knows where it's at. Well, suddenly we hear the sirens and everybody started to run. They're jumping under doors and tables. Well, I heard somebody shooting a gun. Well, the DA was pumping my left hand, and she was a holding my right. Well, I told her, don't get scared, 'cause you're gonna be spared. I gotta be forbidden if I wanna spend my living with a long, cool woman in a black dress, just 5'9", beautiful, tall. Well, with just one look, I was a bad mess, 'cause that long, cool woman had it all. Long Cool Woman, 1972, The Hollies, and yeah, why would I play a song like that? It could pertain to tonight's theme. Hello and welcome to everybody tuning in tonight on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and Twitch. Thank you for tuning in to tonight's Susie on Sunday's show, and I hope you enjoy tonight's unusual themed show. Thanks to all of our front row seats participants joining us backstage here on StreamYard. I can see you down here, and I hope you are enjoying the proceedings. Coordinating tonight's show, as with all of these Sunday shows, is Kelly Lynn Natt out in Minneapolis, our tech wizard and a singer-songwriter herself. Her Tuesday night Facebook shows are not to be missed. This evening's set list is a set of songs tailored for discussion with my guest, former FBI assistant director and MSNBC contributor, Frank Figliuzzi. Friends, would you please welcome to the program my friend Frank. Hey, Frank, how are you tonight?
Hey, Susan. You know, all the times I have appeared live on national television, I have never been introduced by the Hollies. So... There's a first time for everything.
But maybe that's going to be your theme song, right? When you have a radio talk show, right? That's going to be your, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the program, right?
Yeah. Well, or maybe, I don't know about long, cool woman in a black dress, but there's a certain short woman in my life that does have a black dress.
Yeah, that, well, you know. Yeah. We could change the lyrics if you can get the rights. But I did want to play that song because I wanted to ask you about it. Because in your line of work as assistant director of the FBI, there may be a few misperceptions that you can correct for us about FBI work, including would you be shaking the DA man's hand as in that song by the Hollies? Is there anything in that song that would be real at all?
I think the whiskey bottles piled high, those lyrics.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's probably, that probably describes a lot of supervisor conferences I've attended.
I had to ask you about it because when I mentioned to my audience you were going to join us, boy, I got lots of requests for that long, cool woman. And our guest tonight is Frank Figliuzzi, and Frank has written a book, which is due out in January. And it's called The FBI Way, And you're going to do, Frank, you're going to do the audiobook too for this, right?
Yeah, actually, I just finished doing that. And boy, was that an experience. You have far more experience in a recording studio than I do, Susan. But I have to tell you, you would think reading your book would be a pretty simple exercise. And it's a lot harder than I thought. And by the way, this English lit major and law school grad thought I did a pretty good job with the English language until I had a producer in my ear saying, you know, you're mispronouncing that word. So yes, there is an audible version. And yes, it took me at least 3 days to get through it in a professional studio. I'm excited about it. You get to hear my emotion and my passion on the stories. And I think it worked out well.
I look forward to hearing it. And I'm going to be ordering 20 different copies to give to people for the holidays and in the new year. And I'm just real happy to have you with me. Frank and I have known each other for a couple of years, and I was just really happy when he thought he might join this show. So tonight's going to be some serious and some less than entirely serious material. Some of it having to do with law enforcement, and some of it having to do with music and where these two things intersect. So I'm going to do a song here for you now from a project I did called Hayseed, songs about farms, farmers, and the people who love them. And it goes like this. He wore a straw hat on his head and a tomcat in his smile. I told him he should understand this before he walked me down the aisle. You can have the money from the oats, the money from the cow, the money from the goats, and the money from the sow. But don't you ever touch the egg money. That's crossing the line. Don't you ever touch the egg money. The egg money is mine. We had 7 good years. Then the trouble all began. First he started nipping at the gin. Then he started seeing Marianne. Then he started gambling dice, lost the horses and the plow. I felt behind the stove, there was nothing there now. He had taken all the egg money. That's crossing the line. Don't you ever touch the egg money. The egg money is mine. Leaving would have been the thing to do, but no one left in 1922. So the angel that I am poured the coffee in his cup, served his toast with butter and jam, and the eggs were sunny side up, and the eggs were maybe too old, and the eggs had maybe gone bad 3 days and the body went cold. Doctor said it's terribly sad. Don't you ever touch the egg money. Sing it, ladies. That's crossing the line. don't you ever touch the egg money. Sing it! The egg money is mine. Don't you ever touch the egg money, yeah. That's crossing the line. Don't you ever touch the egg money. The egg money is mine. Egg money. Salmonella. Food safety, friends.
Susan, did I just hear a confession in the form of a song? Is that essentially what that was?
Yeah, I'm an imaginary character. The song is called, yeah, The Confession of Irene Broghammer is the subtitle of the song. But I wanted to ask you about, is that a perfect crime? Is that a perfect crime?
There are no perfect crimes. The laboratory probably would have figured out that something was not right with this guy's system. But I haven't seen a perfect crime yet. People have thought about icicles and the use of ice.
Icicles, that's one.
Icicles,
for sure, right?
Yeah, as weapons. Yeah.
Yeah, or like a frozen steak. Right? Have you heard of that one? Steak, and then you eat the steak, right, later.
Yeah, true. You've eaten the evidence. True.
Exactly. Yeah, the icicle, that's a classic, right? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Wasn't there a Gatorade one in recent years? Somebody was putting something in his wife's Gatorade when she would work out.
Yeah, but again, that's going to leave a forensic trace. You got to get better than that, Susan. You gotta get better.
I ask you every year when I see you, I'm like, is this the year I can rob a bank? And you're always like, that's not a...
Bank robbery is one of the stupidest crimes that you could commit. You're gonna get trapped in the lobby on the way out. They're gonna give you a dye pack that explodes, some marked money. They're gonna take your video. It's not good.
So bank robbery, you'd advise against that as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, yeah. There's something like an 80% clearance rate on bank robbers.
80% clearance meaning 80% they find you.
Solution. Yeah.
Right. My guest tonight, Frank Figliuzzi, former assistant director of the FBI, and he's going to weigh in on songs, and here's a song with a story in it. This story set, I guess this was a real story, though of course it's my imaginary take on what the character would have been thinking, but this is set in East Texas in like 1926. I don't want to think about it or take a backwards look. I don't want to hear him saying how I might have got took. All I know is when I met you, my whole little world shook. I just want to be with you. I just want to be with you. And I don't want to know the difference between a wrong and a right. All I know is when I met you, it was love at first sight. Hair wild as a windstorm, eyes dark as the night. I just want to be with you. I just want to be with you. So drive me, baby, around the bend. We'll take this highway to the end. There's no turning back again. And I don't want to know the reason why my marriage didn't last. Say it's over when it's over. Call the past the past. Throw the money in a suitcase and then drive away fast. I just want to be with you. I just want to be with you. And I don't want to know the meaning. I don't want to understand why I like to hold a pistol in the palm of my hand. Why you only feel the first time that you gotta kill a man. I just wanna be with you, I just wanna be with you. So drive me, baby, around the bend. We'll take this highway to the end. There's no turning back again. So hold me close right by your side. If this is our last ride, Jesus Christ, I love you, Clyde. The last words of Bonnie Parker from Kickin' the Beehive 2010. So I started writing that song kind of as a, I just want to be, it was some kind of longing. I just want to be with you. And then I kind of started to think, who, this belongs to somebody. Who's talking? And it's not me, or maybe it's someone like me a little, but who is it? And then it kind of telescoped back into Bonnie Parker, as in Bonnie and Clyde, Bonnie Parker. And maybe some of us, Frank, who are creative individuals, like maybe we're trying to find our way into what mindset would bring us who are not inclined to break the law. But maybe we can see ourselves breaking the law if we follow somebody else into it. Does that sound like something that happens, or you see, or you've seen?
Wow, that's a great piece of psychoanalysis you just did, because you know,
I don't know.
Yeah, I think the answer is yes, and I think we've seen cases where people slide into criminality because they feel enabled, or there's a rationale provided by someone they care about and someone they care for, and often they kind of rationalize that I'm along for the ride, literally and figuratively, and that this is part of my love affair with this person, to go along with it, and the sense of adventure and a shared adrenaline experience. But boy, it's like a moth to a flame, that it doesn't end well.
Someone realizes, oh, like, I followed this thing so far, and now the consequences are very real and serious, and yeah.
That's you're not talking about Melania by any chance, are you?
No, that's a song I look forward to writing that. I mm-hmm. haven't written sort of the secret life there. But since we've begun talking about the present administration, maybe it's time for a song here. Yeah. Let me do a song here. from my new record. And before I do that, if you folks have questions tonight for my guest, Frank, please post them in the comments. And we'll ask him a little later in the program to address some of those questions. So go ahead and put those in the comments. And we'll have Frank take a look at those and answer a few of those for you a little later, in the show. Here's a song from the new project, Flyover Country. This song very much modeled on Jimmy Rogers' Mule Skinner Blues. With a bit of a, update. Yeah. Hey, hey, snake oil, certified snake oil here. Oil to ease your trouble, oil to ease your pain. Once you buy my snake oil, you won't see me again. Hey, hey, snake oil, certified snake oil here. Oil to ease your worry, oil to ease your fear. Once you buy my snake oil, you'll never find me here. Hey, hey, snake oil, certified snake oil here. Oil for your confusion, oil for your doubt. Oil to keep the answers in, keep the questions out. Oil for your sorrow, the anger that you feel. Oil for to bring your wayward women down to heel. Oil to keep the unwashed from our sacred shores. Oil for to keep the dark-skinned devil from your door. Oil for the good old days of your memory. Oil for to make this nation like it used to be. Hey, hey, snake oil, certified dandelion, watered down turpentine, pixie dust and possum brine, yellow piss of porcupine, tablespoon of rot gut shine, anything but genuine snake oil. Snake oil from Flyover Country. Anything there, Frank, that sounds familiar?
Well, I hate to keep bringing things back to current times, Susan, but snake oil, it really, you know, snake oil might want to be a theme song for Trump rallies or, as they call them, super spreader events. We really, you know, in all seriousness, we haven't had the kind of protest music that we saw coming out of the 60s. There's a handful of it, but we haven't seen it. In fact, really what we've seen are a number of high profile musicians like Bruce Springsteen and Neil Young and Phil Collins filing cease and desist orders so that Trump won't play their music during the rallies. And I, you know, it's what Springsteen filed a cease and desist back in 16 for Born in the USA, which no politician, including Reagan, seems to understand the meaning of. And then Neil Young with Keep on Rockin' in the USA, and now I think last week Phil Collins filed a cease and desist for Something in the Air Tonight. So we know musicians don't want Trump associated with their music, but we need more musicians talking about things like snake oil that get sold by slick salesmen or commercial real estate businessmen from Manhattan.
Well, you mentioned that protest songs, some of them have there aren't quite as many as there may have been during a certain period of history. And let me do a song here that might be related to what you're talking about. This is from 1971, this is John Lennon. I'm sick and tired of hearing things from uptight, short-sighted, narrow-minded hypocritics. All I want is the truth. Just give me some truth. I've had enough of reading things by neurotic, psychotic, pig-headed politicians. All I want is the truth. Just give me some truth. No short-haired, yellow-bellied son of Tricky Dicky's gonna Mother Hubbard soft soap me with just a pocket full of hope. Money for dough, money for rope. I'm sick to death of seeing things from tight-lipped, condescending mama's little chauvinists. All I want is the truth. Just give me some truth. I've had enough of watching scenes with schizophrenic, egocentric, paranoiac prima donnas. All I want is the truth. Just give me some truth. No short-haired, yellow-bellied son of Tricky Dicky's gonna Mother Hubbard soft soap me with just a pocket full of hope. Money for dough, money for rope. And that's a saying, money for old rope is a way, I guess, in English, in Great Britain and England, of not working too hard and getting something kind of for free. Money for old rope. I'm sick to death of hearing things from uptight, short-sighted, narrow-minded hypocrites. All I want is the truth. Just give me some truth. All I want is the truth. Just give me some truth. Give me some truth, John Lennon from 1971. Yeah, how about those lyrics there? No short-haired, yellow-bellied son of Tricky Dicky.
Wow. I mean, you know, why don't we have more songs like this today? Truth, it's all about truth. Look at what we're going through right now. And I know it's a Sunday evening and we're getting ready for the work week and what will likely be another outrageous week of news. But even today, we heard more about QAnon. We heard more ridiculous allegations and assertions and fabrications. And we've got a significant portion of our society just believing utter, complete, fabricated nonsense. One of the songs that keeps coming back in my mind, and I actually talked about it with one of the MSNBC hosts, Ari Melber, who has a show called The Beat, and he's all about applying music lyrics to today's news. And I mentioned Simon Garfunkel and the boxer. A man hears what he wants to hear and disregards the rest. That's where we are. We're in our own echo chambers. Whatever news source we get our news from, we just can't hear the other side. The other side's evil. We don't know what truth is. Rudy Giuliani famously said on Meet the Press one day, the truth isn't truth. You know, it's not the truth. What are you talking about? And so the other thing that comes up with QAnon is, in my mind, is a Doobie Brothers song, What a Fool Believes. You know, and there's a lyric in there that says, what a fool believes, no wise man has the power to reason away. We've lost the ability to have logic and reason in our discussions.
How do we agree then, do you think, on an objective truth? I mean, if you think about years, you know, when I was a little kid, I mean, there was Walter Cronkite and everybody kind of watched this. And I don't know if Walter Cronkite told the complete truth, but I mean, we seem to agree on some storytellers, some reliable narrators. How might we recreate, you think, some kind of truth that most of us can agree on? How do we do that?
We've got a long road ahead of repairing the damage that's been done to our institutions, our concept of truth. It's not going to be easy. It really isn't. This is going to take leader after leader that can restore trust and credibility. Because this doesn't change overnight, and the news industry won't change overnight either. It sells. It gives them ratings to be polarized, extreme, and outrageous. And we've got to find a middle before we lose the whole thing.
My guest tonight, Frank Figliuzzi, has a new book coming out in January called The FBI Way. And if you want to thank Frank for his participation in tonight's program, please go ahead and pre-order that book via Amazon, via the link that our friend Kelly Lynn Knott has been putting up tonight. And we certainly thank Frank for staying with me this hour. Here's a song. Here's a song There's a man who leads a life of danger. To everyone he meets, he stays a stranger. With every move he makes, another chance he takes. Odds are he won't live to see tomorrow. Secret agent man, secret agent man, they have given you a number, taking away your name. Beware of pretty faces that you find. A pretty face can hide an evil mind. Ah, be careful what you say, or you'll give yourself away. Odds are you won't live to see tomorrow. Secret agent man, secret agent man, they have given you a number and taken away your name. Take it, Frank. Give it back. Swinging on the Riviera one day, then laying in the Bombay Alley next day. Oh, you let the wrong word slip while kissing persuasive lips like Maria Butina's. The odds are you won't live to see tomorrow. Secret agent man, secret agent man, they've given you a number and taken away your name.
That is some serious guitar playing. That really is. Hey, I know you had to play that song. You had to get it out of your system.
Had to do it.
But I've got to tell you, you know, the secrecy that I lived my life in during 25 years in the FBI, which ended in leading all counterintelligence for the Bureau. If somebody had told me that someday I would be on national TV on a regular basis, trying to explain complex counterintelligence concepts to the American public, I would have said, what the hell happened? What are you talking about? What has gone so horribly wrong that you need me to talk about what should be behind the scenes shadow work that no one has to ever worry about, right? And here we are.
To me like we all learned a lot in the last 4 years of things that we didn't really want to know about.
What I used to tell people, and I still do, is that's why we have an FBI. So you don't have to worry about this stuff all day. But now we're all wrapped up in it.
Before you take a few questions, Frank. I wanted to ask, what do you tell the younger generation about your line of work, and whether you would, I mean, I assume that you would encourage people to go into this as a line of work and to serve their nation in this way. Do you have thoughts about that?
Yeah, I love talking to young people about careers in public service, and I would live it all over again. There's no regrets. I'd do it. It is the adventure of a lifetime. But I do say this to young people. This is not just another job. This is a vocation. Mm-hmm. It's a calling. There's an element of sacrifice. And I write about this extensively in the book. You know, we are conservators in the Bureau of the nation's democratic values. We swear an oath to protect, preserve, defend the Constitution. That doesn't stop at 5 p.m. That doesn't stop because it's a holiday or a weekend or your kids have a ball game. So there's sacrifice there. But I have to tell you, the sacrifice is worth it in terms of protecting the nation.
Vocation is an interesting word, right? Because it means, I mean, a little, not exactly like being a musician, but something about that it has to feel, you must feel really passionate about it, and you have to be okay with it going beyond the 9 to 5 of your day. It's going to occupy your mind and your imagination and your best energies. And
you know, a guy by the name of Jim Comey, who was fired as FBI director, wrote a book called A Higher Loyalty. And that's actually what he was talking about. He was talking about being loyal, not to a president, even though he was asked to be loyal to a president, but being loyal rather to a higher calling. And that's the Constitution.
Yeah. Did you see some questions or?
I saw, well, these are great questions. I saw one that caught my eye because it's actually humorous. And since it's Sunday evening, we'll try not to get too deep here, but someone's asked me to retell the story of Bat Boy. So that means that they've heard me tell this story. And here it is in a nutshell. So one of the things I did in my time in the Bureau was because every day was unprecedented, but I became the on-scene commander at the site of the first anthrax murder in U.S. history. That was in Boca Raton, Florida. Right. And it was at the site of American Media Incorporated, the home to the tabloid newspapers like The Inquirer. And of course, who at the time, and it was still, is the CEO of The Inquirer and all these tabloids, a guy by the name of David Pecker. So we have a building filled with anthrax. It's three stories, 60,000 square feet. We know the thing is badly contaminated. Somebody has died working inside from anthrax. We get Pecker on the call. He's in New York or somewhere. And we go, hey, we're going in. We're going into your office. We may have one chance and one chance only to take the most valuable possessions you have in your office and get them out and try to decontaminate them. What is it you want us to try and grab? He says, there's two things. Right outside my office, there's a giant framed photo of Elvis Presley in his coffin. And right next to it is a photo of Bat Boy. Get those out. Those were the two most valuable things. Now, for those who aren't, and I had to educate myself, for those who have no idea what Bat Boy is, it's some fabricated man, boy, bat creature that ended up being one of the highest selling tabloid covers in the history of The Inquirer or Sun News or World News, whatever it is. Those are the two things. When it came down to life and death, he wanted those two things out of his office.
Wow.
Yeah, there's the Bat Boy story.
Yeah, if you're on your laptop tonight or near your phone, you'll want to look up Bat Boy because he was interesting looking, Bat Boy. not something you see every day. I wanted to ask you if you had heard of, since we're talking about maybe some of the lighthearted ways that arts and law enforcement intersect. I don't know if I asked you the other day about the My Way killings.
No.
Okay. So I found this on Wikipedia, which means, you know, should you trust it or not? I don't know. But the My Way killings are a social phenomenon in the Philippines, referring to a number of fatal disputes related to the singing of the song My Way in karaoke bars. The New York Times estimated 6 killings in 2010 alone. One explanation may be what could be perceived as aggressive lyrics. The triumphalist theme may have an aggravating effect on singers and listeners alike. The words evoke feelings of pride and arrogance in the singer. So if you're somebody, as if you're somebody when you're really nobody, it covers up your failures, and that's why it leads to fights. And some Filipinos, even those who love the song, will not sing it in public in order to avoid trouble. And in a related story, in 2008, a man was arrested in Thailand for shooting his brother-in-law in a dispute stemming from repeated renditions of John Denver's Take Me Home, Country Roads. And in 2014, last anecdote, a karaoke singer in Seattle, Washington was attacked and beaten by a woman who wanted him to stop singing Coldplay's Yellow. And yes, I pled guilty. Had you heard of the karaoke killings? Did you run across that in your travels and your work? Or
I've run across just about everything, but no, not links to. I don't want to get into Frank Sinatra and alleged killings. But, yeah. We won't go there. But no, that's there. Really, really fascinating. I'm sure the Bureau has profilers they might send to the Philippines to take a look.
The karaoke raids unit. You got to send them in.
My word.
Yep. Here's a song you had talked about. Cease and Desist. Yeah.
Well, I won't back down, won't back down. You can stand me up at the gates of hell, but I won't back down. I'm gonna stand my ground, won't be turned around. And I'll keep this world from dragging me down. Gonna stand my ground, and I won't back down. Hey, baby, there ain't no easy way out. Hey, I will stand my ground. And I won't back down. Well, I know what's right. I got just one life. In a world that keeps on pushing me around, stand my ground, and I won't back down. The current president played this song at a highly publicized campaign rally in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Tom Petty's widow Dana, ex-wife Jane, and daughters Adria and Anna Kim issued a statement making it clear they did not approve. Both the late Tom Petty and his family firmly stand against racism and discrimination of any kind, they wrote.
Tom Petty would never want a song of his used for a campaign of hate. He liked to bring people together. Tom wrote the song for the underdog, for the common man, and for everyone. I won't back down. I love those lines. Well, I know what's right, and I got just one life.
You know, Susan, on the don't back down theme, I encounter so many people, and this also applies to me sometimes, that have what I call outrage fatigue, and they feel like they just can't take it anymore. And the don't back down song is right on the money, because this is about our democracy. It's really not about how much we can take anymore. It's about how much we want to save what we have. Great song. I also see some more great questions being asked. So,
ooh, help yourself.
Well, hey, somebody asked how you can actually request your own FBI file. And the thing is, in our form of government, or at least the form of government we're trying to protect, you can actually make a request, go online at FBI.gov, find the FOIA, Freedom of Information Act, link, and say, hey, I'd like to see if you have anything on me. And unless you're being actively investigated, say, for example, you might be a singer-songwriter singing about killing people with eggs. unless there's an active investigation on you, if the Bureau has anything on you, they'll send it to you. That's the country we live in.
So I heard this story from Richie Havens, because I had the good fortune to open for Richie Havens many times. And I don't know if everyone out there knows who Richie Havens was, but he's the guy who sang Freedom at Woodstock. Tremendous singer and interpreter and just an exceptional human being. He was amazing. He was really a wonderful, wonderful, surpassingly wonderful person. And I said to him once backstage, I said, Richie, I don't know how it came up, but I said something like, Richie, like, do you think like the government follows you or something because you were at Woodstock? He says, I got my FBI file. I applied for it. I said, you did? He said, yeah, I got it. I said, was it like, you know, this thick with stuff on you, you know, with paperwork? And he said, no, I opened it. It was empty. I said, why do you think it was empty? He said, oh, they don't worry about people like me. They know everything I'm thinking.
Most people are sorely disappointed when they get their FBI file. It's like, you know. Somebody interviewed you once because you were being a neighbor applied for a government job. There it is. That's about it.
Wow.
Yeah.
So maybe it's true that if you're a person who keeps your nasty thoughts entirely to yourself and you do scary things, then there's a file on you, right? But if you say everything you think comes right out your mouth, then the government isn't terribly worried about you because they know what you're going to do, maybe?
I think there's something to be said for that. And look, to take this back to investigative seriousness, look at what we're dealing with online extremism right now. Look at the group that the FBI took down in Michigan, that trying to kidnap the governor there. It's what's going on in private chat rooms, encrypted chat rooms, people plotting things I don't even want to talk about tonight, but it's what you can't see that can hurt you.
Yeah. Did you want to answer another question or two? Because I'm going to play, I know what I'm going to play here as we head toward the exit, but I want to make sure and get a couple more questions in if you saw some.
Yeah, I mean, people are asking great questions. One is, how much lead time do I get before I go on TV as to the topic? And the answer is, it depends. It depends on the host, the show, the day, the breaking news or not. The example, of course, tragically, of when I have zero lead time is some horrible crisis like a mass shooting, which happens all too often. And you literally just have to react, talk about what's going on investigatively. There are times, sadly, when I've been on all day, the El Paso Walmart shooting, et cetera, with something like that. And then the other extreme is I might have up to 3 or 4 days to know that they have a certain thing in mind, or at least get booked. The most I'll get booked in advance is a week. Some host knows they want to squeeze me in sometime next week, but they don't know the topic. So the topic generally comes to me an hour to 2 hours beforehand, and I've got to try to make sense of it. And all I get, Susan, is the topic. Maybe the Washington Post did a report, or New York Times or something, and I need to react to it. That's it.
And you don't have a teleprompter to look at, right? You're just in a room, right?
I don't know what would be on the teleprompter, but because it's me, it's just me and my brain. But it's me and a camera. That's it.
Yeah. Like, you know, you see my my high-tech teleprompter here.
There you go.
My high-tech setup here. My guest tonight, Frank Figliuzzi, and want to make sure and mention again that Frank has a book coming out in January, a book he wrote, and he's going to do the audiobook too, which I look forward to hearing, and I look forward to speeding up your voice and then slowing it down and then speeding it up and slowing it down.
Well, I sound like I'm on helium or...
Yeah, I actually like that feature. All right. Speed listening. You can order Frank's book, The FBI Way, via Amazon, also HarperCollins. And that's how we're thanking Frank tonight for his participation in tonight's show. And I'm sure grateful for him joining us. Also, to mention, I have a new record out called Flyover Country, and that song Snake Oil's on there. Yes, it is country themed.
Before you go on, I've got to say something because I have so many people who tell me, you know, Frank, you are a voice of truth and honesty for us. So I'm going to give you something truthful and honest. I've listened in its entirety to Susan's new album. And I got to tell you, I actually think every single one of those songs has the potential to be a hit in and of itself. And it may be the best album she's done, although I know artists don't like to talk about that because they're wedded to their albums, but it's awesome. And I highly recommend it.
Thanks so much. I appreciate that. And, sure. The reception has been really, really wonderful to the record, and it's really gratifying. It's gratifying this year, especially to feel useful. I think that so many of us are locked down and how can we be, you know, helpful and keep people company and, you keep them informed. I just, you know, sing on pitch on Tuesdays. Want to mention, too, that I'm doing a video of the song, the track one off the new record, Long Live My Little Hometown. So we want to invite you to send in videos of yourself singing along the lyrics. And maybe a picture of you next to, you know, the sign in your town says, welcome to Manchester, Iowa, in my case. But send those on in to the link that Kelly has included here. Upcoming events, Frank, I'm going to make you listen to these, I'm afraid. You're welcome to join me at any of these events if you can get there. This Thursday, I'm going to be in New Bedford, Massachusetts, with the one and only Trina Hamlin, who is fabulous on harmonic and percussion. So that's this Thursday, October 22nd, New Bedford. Next Sunday, Susie on Sundays, is Piano Bar Night. Your requests in real time. Perhaps I'll play some of those karaoke rage songs that are requested. Friday, October 30th, at the Avalon Theater in Easton, Maryland, on the Eastern Shore of Maryland. This is a great theater and a great setup. Friday, October 30th, Easton, Maryland. Join me there underneath the big tent. Sunday, November 1st, Susie on Sundays, pre-election stress, I can't take it anymore, comedy night with my ex-husband, not really, but, my ex-husband, comedian and songwriter, the one and only Vance Gilbert, will join me to help us manage the stress as we head toward election day. Sunday, November 8th, I'll be doing songs of social distance, songs of longing, being far away, etc. And, I want to play this song with Frank in our room because this song kind of is, it's what they call an evergreen. And this is one of those songs you talked about. There should be more songs like this. And boy, does this one do a lot of talking tonight. Play this one by Bob Dylan. Come gather round, people, wherever you roam, and admit that the waters around you have grown, and accept it that soon you'll be drenched to the bone. If your time to you is worth saving, well, you better start swimming or you'll sink like a stone. For the times, they are changing. Come, senators, congressmen, please heed the call. Don't stand in the doorway, don't lock up the hall, for he that gets hurt will be he who has stalled. The battle outside is raging, and it'll soon shake your windows and rattle your walls, for the times they are changing. Come mothers and fathers throughout the land, and don't criticize what you can't understand. Your sons and your daughters are beyond your command. Your old road is rapidly aging. Please get out of the new one if you can't lend a hand. For the times, they are changing. The line it is drawn, the curse it is cast. The slow one now will later be fast, as the present now will later be past. The order is rapidly fading, and the first one now will later be last. For the times, they are a change.
Frank, do you have some final thoughts for our audience on what we can do to help the American experiment hold together?
Yeah, look, what a great song to wrap with. The change that has to come from us. I think so many times I've encountered folks saying, when is this agency going to save us? When is this person going to save us? Who should we pick for this or that? Here's the bottom line from someone who spent 25 years in the bureaucracy of government. No agency is going to save us. The change that you want in our society is going to come from us. And the greatest change agent we have is called an election. And that's coming up very, very soon.
Friends, let's thank. Let's thank Frank Figliuzzi. Frank, thanks for joining the show tonight. Really an honor and a pleasure. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Frank's book is called The FBI Way, and it is available now via HarperCollins and via Amazon. And I want to thank all of our front row seats folks who are joining us tonight. And I'm going to play a song now to close us out. See you all next week for Piano Bar Night. And this is a song that would work for Piano Bar Night, but also sort of works tonight. So I'm going to close with this, send this out with love to Frank and his family and our sponsors tonight down in University Park, Florida. Sing along with this big old cheese ball from 1977, written by Marvin Hamlisch, lyrics by Carol Bayer Sager. Nobody does it better. Makes me feel sad for the rest. Nobody does it half as good as you. Baby, you're the best. I wasn't looking, but somehow you found me. I tried to hide from your love light, but like heaven above me, the spy who loved me is keeping all my secrets safe tonight. Nobody does it better. Though sometimes I wish someone would.
nobody does it quite the way you do. Why'd you have to be so good? The way that you hold me, whenever you hold me. Sing it. There's some kind of magic inside you that keeps me from running. So just keep it coming. West of the Mississippi. Sing. Makes me feel sad for the rest. Everybody east of the Mississippi. Nobody does it half as good. Nobody does it half as good as you.